great to be here and so great to see everyone out. Could not think of a better place in all the world to be than right here at the Lafayette Church of Christ. We are so glad that you have chosen to come our way today. And what a beautiful song, "Not a Step Will I Take Without Jesus." Makes me almost wish I could, in a spur of a moment, change my sermon, but I can't do that. I've already got the PowerPoint put together and everything, but that's a great thought, isn't it? And wouldn't it be great in the year 2020 to live every day, not one single step without Jesus? That sounds like a good thing for 2021, don't you? You know, there are so many different blessings that you and I have as a Christian. But I suppose one of my favorite is the blessing of prayer. How great it is that you and I, as children of God, have the opportunity to call upon God any day of the week, any time of the day, and to always know that He will hear us and that He will answer us. I think about so many passages in the Bible that talk about prayer that are so very dear to me, and I'm sure they're likewise dear to you also. One of my favorite is 1 Peter 3 and verse 12, and though I often like to quote these, sometimes it's good for us to just read it and sponge on it. "For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and His ears are open to their prayers, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil." Isn't that an encouraging verse, to know that God is always watching us and that He's always ready to listen to us, to hear us? Other favorites is 1 John 5 and verse 14. "Now this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us." Again, what great confidence you and I have in the privilege of prayer. And then I can't forget this one: "My voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning I will direct it to you, and I will look up." What was the first thing that David did when he arose in the morning? He prayed. Isn't that a great way to start your day? And it's not just the fact that he started out his day in prayer, but prayer was something that he made a habit, a part of his day, each day that he lived. "Evening and morning and at noon will I pray and cry aloud, and he shall hear my voice." Again, you see David, an individual who has not only a time when he gets up in the morning and he sets aside to pray, but throughout the day, in the evening, in the morning, in the daytime, it seems as if his day was just consumed with the attitude of prayer. I want to suggest and tell you that David was an individual who prayed more than just in the morning and at noontime and at evening, but he was an individual who saturated his life with prayer. 2020. An age wherein we have never graced before until this time. 5 days into a brand new year. And you know, there are many different things that you and I can vow to do in this new year. But if there's one thing that every person gathered in this room here this morning ought to do, is we ought to saturate this year with prayer. Amen. Wouldn't you agree? I mean, you think about a ground that you plan to plant and you want it to reap and you want it to harvest. You're not just going to go out there and you're just going to throw seeds down. What are you going to do? You're going to go in, you're going to cut the ground, you're going to put fertilizer on it, you're going to keep the weeds out. Why don't we treat this year with prayer like that, brothers and sisters? Why don't we fertilize this year? Why don't we cultivate this year in prayer? Every single day of our lives, be those individuals that we pray constantly. And though there are many individuals that we could think of and individuals that we could refer to and think about, great examples of prayer throughout the Bible, I want to focus your attention, if you allow me this morning, on an individual in the Old Testament. It's an individual by the name of Jabez. And I hope that you will open your Bible to the passage that Brother Wayne read for us in the book of 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verses 9 through 10, because that's going to be our lesson text this morning. Jabez is an individual who prayed a prayer that I believe would be a prayer that you and I should pray in the lives that we live, not just this day, and not just in this year that God affords us to live, but every day that we live. Now, when we think about Jabez, I think we ought to start, first of all, by talking about who was Jabez. I think we need to know something about him. We need to know who he was. When we understand who he was, that's going to come into play when you see the result of this prayer. When you drop down to verse 10, you should be amazed with the fact that when he made a certain request to God, the Bible just plainly says that God gave it to him. So God granted him what he required, or what he requested. And so I'm going to suggest and tell you that God just didn't just graciously give this to Jabez for no reason at all. There was something about Jabez. It was the kind of person who he was that caused God to answer his prayer. We need to know who he was. And we need to take who he was and apply it to who we are today so we can have confidence that God will answer our prayers. Number one, when we ask ourselves the question, who was Jabez? The interesting thing about him is this is the only time in the scripture that he is found. Only right here in 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verses 9 through 10. He's not found in any other place in the Bible. But if you back up into verse 1, you're going to learn that what's taking place here is there's a description of the family of the tribe of Judah. And so that indicates to us that Jabez was from the tribe of Judah. And someone might say, well, how does that help us? The tribe of Judah was not any ordinary tribe. There were several things about Judah that we ought to take note of. I want to make mention of just two. Number one, when you think about the tribe of Judah, it was a tribe of royalty. It was a tribe from which David and Solomon, kings of Israel, came. And so this tribe is recognized throughout the scriptures, a tribe wherein great royal families came from. But it's not just David and Solomon that came from this tribe. Jesus came from this tribe. He's described in the Bible as the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Lion who became a lamb. Isn't that ironic? But when you think about this tribe, Jesus came from the tribe of Judah. Now, how does that help us today? You and I may not be from the physical tribe of Judah, but I'm going to tell you what we are. The Bible describes us as priests and kings of his people. Note, if you will, in the book of Revelation chapter 1 and verse 5, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Now watch what he says, watch it. And has made us, that's you and me, kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Now whether you believe it or not, that doesn't change the fact of what the scripture says. Do you realize who you are in the eyes of God as you sit where you are this morning? You are a king. You are a priest of God. Now how does that help me? A king and a priest of God is an individual who is worthy of being heard. You and I may not think much of ourselves sometimes, but we need to understand that you and I are God's children. John would say in the book of 1 John chapter 3 and verse 1, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the children of God. You and I are the blessed, privileged children of God. And one of the many blessings that we have as God's people is, you name it, what is it? It's prayer. Because you are God's child, you can call upon him and you can know, as we saw at the very beginning of this study, that God's going to hear you. He is sitting there. He's waiting. He already knows what you want, but he's waiting for you to pray. You and I need to realize in this new year we ought to saturate it with prayer. And if there is a reason why we ought to, it's because of the privileged position we're in. We have the privilege, the opportunity, the blessing to be able to call upon God right now, any moment of every day, and to know that God will hear us. Let us take advantage of that opportunity. But there's a second thing that I learned about the tribe of Judah when I study it in depth. It was a tribe from which, it was a tribe of courage. You think about Jesus Christ. In the book of Genesis chapter 49, verses 8 through 10, the Bible speaks there that the scepter would never depart from the tribe of Judah. Now, most people will conclude that this is a direct reference to Jesus Christ. And when you go to Revelation chapter 5 and verse 5, and you read about the tribe or the line of Judah. In that particular passage of Scripture, I believe the Revelation writer is talking about Jesus Christ. He is the Lamb, as John would say in John chapter 1 and verse 29, but He is the Lion who became a lamb so that man could be saved. And when you think about a lion, what comes to your mind? You think of courage. I think of Caleb. You remember those 12 tribes who went into the land to spy it out and to see if it was good. And there were 12 of them that went, and 10 of them came back with bad, evil reports. But you remember the two who came back with good reports? It was Joshua and Caleb. Tell me what tribe Caleb was from. You don't have to tell me. I already know. He was from the tribe of Judah. How could he go in there and see something totally different, looking at the same identical thing? It was because he was a man of courage. And brothers and sisters in Christ, when it comes to prayer, if there is something that you and I ought to have, is we ought to have courage. Remember who we are. We are kings. We are priests. We are sons and daughters of God. And because of our privileged position, we ought to approach the throne of God with courage. Brothers and sisters, you can't think of prayer and not think about courage. Because when you have the opportunity to pray, it is coupled with courage. We ought to approach God with courage. In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 16, let us therefore come boldly, in other words, courageously, to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. Look at what it says. You and I should approach the throne of God with boldness. You remember the story in the book of Luke, the 11th chapter, with the friend at midnight, and how that he came to that individual and he needed bread, and the Bible says that the man would not get up and give him bread, but because of his importunity. You remember that? You know what importunity means, don't you? Continual persistence. But that word importunity carries the idea of boldness. That man was not going to allow anything to keep him from going and getting bread for his friend who had come. And the teaching in that passage is that you and I should not allow anything to keep us from approaching the God that we serve in this life. I want to suggest then to you that one of the things about Jabez that caused his prayer to be so powerful is because of who he was and the kind of person he was. He was an individual who was from the tribe of Judah. He was royalty. He was from the tribe of a royal group of people, and he was an individual who was courageous. But note, if you will, that the Bible specifically says that there's something else about this man. Look at verse 9. Now Jabez was more honorable than his brother. And so the Bible describes him as being honorable. Question is, what does that word honorable mean? It literally refers to a person who is impressive, or get this, an individual who is worthy of respect. What in the world would make this man, that we read about him only one time in the Scripture, honorable, worthy of respect? Consider some thoughts with me. Number one, I want to suggest unto you that he was righteous. Why? Look at Proverbs 21:21. He who follows righteousness and mercy finds life, righteousness. Now look at what it says, honor. How is it that you and I get to a position of honor? It's because of righteousness. What is righteousness? Righteousness is simply right living. One who is righteous is one who is in a right relationship with God. In other words, they have complied with the teachings that are found in God's Word. Righteousness is living in according to those principles found in God's Word. Jabez was an honorable person because he was righteous. Now, if you and I want to have the same results as Jabez, what do we need to be? We need to be people who are righteous. If we're going to be honorable people, and we need to be honorable people in order to have our prayers answered, we need to be those who are righteous. In this new year, may we be individuals that we live every day. Number one, if you're not in a right relationship with God, you've waited 5 days too late. Don't let another one pass by. Do what is necessary this morning. Stop allowing the devil to influence you and to cause you to think that you've got plenty of time, because you don't. You don't know what the future holds. Take the opportunity this morning to obey the gospel of Jesus Christ. And if you're an individual who has already done that, then just press on. Brother J.L. says, keep on keeping on. He's never going to live that phrase down. Because it's a good one. And that's what God wants us to do. If our prayers in 2020, if we're going to saturate our lives with prayer, and we're going to be individuals that our prayers are heard and answered, we need to be honorable people. But number two, I want to suggest unto you, not only was he honorable, but he was humble. Note if you will in Proverbs 15:33, the Bible says, the fear of the Lord is the instruction of wisdom, and before honor, look at it, do you see it? What is it? It's humility. If I'm going to live in an honorable position, if I'm going to be worthy of respect, what must I be? I've got to be humble. What does it mean to be humble? The word humble means not only to recognize your position in life, but it also refers to one who depends on others and one who strives to help others. One who recognizes where he was and how he got to where he is, and he wants others to be in that same position. That's humility. And that's what we must be. We are Christians. But brothers and sisters in Christ, don't let us keep that to ourselves. Let us be individuals that we share the message with others, what we did in order to become Christians. And let us let other people know that we are who we are today because of one and only one, and that's Jesus Christ. I am what I am because of what he has made me to be. Let us be those who are humble, and we will know that our prayers are heard and answered before God. But there's another thing that the Bible, the word honorable means, and I want to suggest unto you that it means that he was an individual who prayed, and he prayed regularly. In verse 9, the Bible says, now Jabez was more honorable than his brothers, and his mother called his name Jabez, saying, because I bore him in pain. And now look at verse 10, the Bible says, Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying. That word called, used in both verse 9 and in verse 10, is what is known as in the imperfect tense in the Hebrew language. Well, what does that mean? It's a progress in motion. It's kind of like a movie you turn on, and that movie just goes on and on and on. And you turn it off and you turn it back on, what happened? The movie is still on. It's just a process. It's not going to end until it gets to the end of the movie. And the idea that's being presented here is this is not the first time that Jabez has called upon God. This is not the first time that he's prayed to God. But he, I would suggest, is much like David. David was one who got up in the morning. What did he do? He prayed to God. As he went throughout his day, what did he do? Morning, noon, and evening. What did he do? He prayed. And that's the attitude of Jabez. And if you and I are going to be honorable, good people, that's what we must be. We have to be individuals who are righteous, yes. We have to be individuals who are humble, yes. But we have to be individuals that we never, ever, ever stop praying. Amen. 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without what? Ceasing. Don't you stop. Don't give up. Don't think because you didn't get this or you didn't get that or this prayer wasn't answered, so you think. God answers all prayers, maybe not in the way that we want him to. But God always answers us. We can't deny those passages that we looked at. His ears are upon the righteous, and they're open to our prayers. And you've got to believe it. Regardless of the results, let us be people that we always pray. And when we do that, we will be honorable. And we will be people who our prayers will be heard and answered. God will give us those things we need in life. Now, in the remainder of the lesson, I want us to look at the request of Jabez. And then I want us to look at the quick result, all right? What was the request? It was very simple. There were four things that he requested. Number one, he requested prosperity. Number two, progress. Number three, presence. And number four, protection. Let's begin first of all with prosperity. Note, if you will, in verse 10, and Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me indeed. You see that? Oh, that you would bless me indeed. The word bless in the Old Testament, when used by man toward God, means literally to kneel before. When we bless God, that means that we kneel before him. But when the word bless is used in reference from God to man, it refers to endue with power for success, prosperity, and longevity. Is it wrong for us to pray that God would bless us physically, perhaps spiritually, perhaps even financially? Some would say no. Some would say you should never pray for prosperity. Is that not exactly what he's praying for right here? Have we forgotten that we serve a God who has seen fit to bless individuals throughout the ages of time? If we were to take the time, and this is not an exhaustive list, and for certain, God blessed Adam and Eve, he blessed Noah, he blessed Abraham, he blessed Job. When Job opens up, or the book of Job opens up, how is Job described? Do you remember in verse 3? We often focus on the fact of the spiritual, and yes, he was a man who was upright, he put God first, but have we forgotten that the Bible says that he was the greatest man of all the East? And folks, that referred to his physical possessions. And how does the book of Job end? Do you remember in chapter 42? God blessed him double of everything he had in the beginning. What does that teach us? It's not the thought that money is the root of all evil. Physical gain is the root of all evil, as some people say. That's not what the Bible says. It's the love of money. Throughout the Scriptures, there are many individuals who were blessed financially, and they used that money to the good. What would be wrong with us praying that God would bless us financially so we can do good, so that we can increase what we give? And so that the good elders of this congregation can take it and use it to the good of the kingdom? Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, that's something we ought to pray for. That God would bless us in a prosperous way. But be sure to understand that when we pray that, we better be ready to use it in a way that God give it. Because the one who gives can also do what? He can take it away. All things that we have today belong to him to begin with. Psalm chapter 5 and verse 12. For you, O Lord, will bless the righteous. With favor you will surround him as with a shield. I mean, there is the promise right there. If we're righteous, what's God going to do? He's going to bless us. Why? Well, because we're righteous. And righteous people do what? They do exactly what God wants them to do. You see, a righteous person, when God blesses them financially, they're going to take it and they're going to use it to the good of the kingdom. And so, brothers and sisters, there's nothing wrong with us praying that God would bless us prosperously. Jabez prayed for it. But a second thing that Jabez prayed for was progress. Not only did he say, oh, that you would bless me indeed, but look at what he says, enlarge my territory. The word enlarge, though, literally means to multiply or to increase. Would it be anything wrong with you and I praying, God, enlarge the territory that we are a part of? What is the kingdom that you and I are a part of? Oh, you know it's the church, right? You and I are part of the kingdom of God, aren't we? When we were baptized into Jesus Christ, we not only became individuals who were born again, born of the water, born of the Spirit, but we were individuals who God took at that moment, according to Acts chapter 2 and verse 47, and he put us in his church, that promised kingdom. We are a part of the kingdom. And we ought to pray that God would bless us in the kingdom, that we would be individuals, that we have progress in the kingdom. Number one, there ought to be progress in the area of physical growth. In the book of Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. That's something that God expects of us. It's something that he wants us to do. Should we pray, and would it be anything wrong that we pray for open doors of opportunities to teach people the gospel of Jesus Christ? Absolutely not. In fact, that's something we ought to pray every day. God, open the door. Give me an individual to teach. Give me a soul that I can show the gospel of Jesus Christ so that they can know and understand the salvation that is found within the good book, the Bible. But not only should we pray for the progress of the kingdom in number, we should pray for the progress of the kingdom when it comes to spiritual growth, shouldn't we? In the book of 2 Peter 3 and verse 18, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Does God want us each person in this congregation, does he want us to grow spiritually? Yes, he does. That's seen right there clearly in the passage that is before us. Would it be anything wrong in this new year to pray every day, God, let's start with our own selves, God, help me to grow spiritually? You see, if I focus on you first, and I'm going to have to be trying to get that mote, that beam out of my eye, I need to start here with David. I need to say, God, help me grow spiritually. Help me become spiritually more mature every day that I live. And then what I need to do is I need to pray for my brethren. How often do we do that? How often do we pray for the Lafayette Church of Christ that each one of us would grow spiritually in the sight of the Lord, more spiritually mature? Brethren, what would the church here at Lafayette be like if we prayed for the prosperity and the progress that God expects us to pray for? But we don't need to stop there. There's a third thing that Jabez requested, and it was the presence of the Lord. Look at what he says. After he said, enlarge my territory, he said, that your hand would be with me. Brethren, that is a phrase that you see throughout the Scripture in the Old Testament and New Testament, that the hand of the Lord would be with me, and it's simply referring to the presence of the Lord. What Jabez is doing right here is he is praying, God, I want you to be with me. Why would he pray that? Because he knew that it was God's desire to be with him. Shouldn't we pray the same prayer today? That the Lord would be with us? Remember the song? Not a step will I take without Jesus. That song's about the presence of the Lord. And then we ought to be those individuals that we pray for the presence of the Lord. Matthew 28 verse 20, Jesus promised, I will never, lo, I'll be with thee always, even to the end of the world. In Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 5, I will never, think about the meaning of that word never, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. That's a promise from God. We need to pray for His presence. Every day, we ought not just sing the song, be with me, Lord, but we ought to pray for it. God, you get up in the morning, you know what we ought to pray? God, be with me today. And the next day, be with me today. And the next day, be with me today. And every day, if we pray for the presence of the Lord, what's the importance of the presence of the Lord? When the Lord is present in our lives, it gives us the ability to say no to the devil, because he's going to tempt you every day. He's going to come at you every day. The presence of the Lord tells him, I don't have room for you in my life. Get. But the presence of the Lord also gives me the power to be the person that I want to be in this new year. Paul would say in Philippians 4:13, I can do most things through Christ who strengthened me. That's not what it said. Brother Don sounded it out. Oh, I could see his mouth go all the way up here. And that's the teaching. I can do all things when Christ is present in my life. And you can do the same thing. You can be a faithful Christian. You can be righteous. You can be honorable. All the things that we've talked about this morning thus far, you can do it with the presence of the Lord. We ought to pray for the presence of the Lord in this new year that God has given us. And then finally, Jabez prayed for protection. Look at the last part of the prayer. That you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. So God granted him what he requested. The word keep there literally means to accomplish or to complete. It describes the progress of construction. Oh, I like that. Because you will see as you travel here, there, and yonder throughout this year, places of construction. And isn't it neat to go by and you see them, they lay the foundation, they go in there and they put the dirt and then they pack it down. And then they go in there and they start from the ground, and slowly but surely they construct up. And that's what Jabez is asking God to do, to protect us, to construct us, to surround us. Is there anything wrong with us praying that God would protect us? Absolutely not. In the book of 2 Thessalonians 3:3, but the Lord is faithful, who will establish you to guard you from the evil one. In the book of Psalm 46:1, God is our refuge. Do you understand what a refuge is? A refuge was a place of safety. We go back to the Old Testament. There were 6 cities of refuge that individuals could go to when they were in danger. And while they were in those cities, they were protected. And the psalmist said, God, you are our refuge, our strength, the very present help. Not distant, not far away in times of trouble. We ought to pray every day in this new year that God would protect us from spiritual evil. There's so much false doctrine out there, brethren. And if we are not careful, it will slip through the doors just like a snake slips under the door into a house. We have to constantly be careful and be on guard. But there's another kind of evil out there that we ought to pray that God protect us from. And that's physical evil. Is it not horrible and absolutely awful of the shooting that took place in the church in Texas last Sunday? I mean, it was just absolutely awful. We had gone to worship that morning. We had enjoyed the Lord's Supper and enjoyed a good sermon. And I got home to find out that during the Lord's Supper, when individuals, as Brother Randall encouraged us this morning to direct our mind to the cross of Christ and what Jesus did for us, while individuals had their heads bowed and reflecting upon the sacrifice of their Savior, evil slipped in, and as a result, 3 lives were taken. Do you know the same thing could happen here at the Lafayette Church of Christ? Don't think for a second that it couldn't. I'm not saying that congregation didn't pray that God would protect them physically. But I'm telling you something, brethren, that's something we ought to pray. We ought to pray that God will protect us spiritually, yes. That nothing but the truth will be presented from this pulpit and from these classroom settings and so forth. But also we ought to pray every day that God will protect us physically. What does the Bible teach when we pray prayers like that? The Bible teaches us that God is going to answer us. In fact, when you look at the results of Jabez's request, it's summed up in the last part of verse 10. So God granted him what he requested. What's so encouraging about that? The same promise is to you and me. Matthew 7:7-8, ask and it will be given you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. The same promise that God made to Jabez, he makes to you, and he makes to me. So if there's something we ought to do in this year, I beg you and I plead with you, saturate it with prayer. And when we do that, brethren, nothing but good's going to come from it. We know that. Let us saturate this new year that God has given us in prayer. You know, one of the things that you could do to make this new year that God has given us even greater is you could become a Christian this morning. If you're here this morning, you're not a child of God, man, what a great opportunity you've been given. God's blessed you with the chance to become a child of God. An individual who, I mean, you're a king and you're a priest in the eyes of God. Come believe that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, repent of your sins, confess your faith in Christ, the Son of God, be baptized for the remission of sins, and you leave here this morning a child of the living God, ready to pray, ready to saturate your life in this year in the avenue of prayer. Maybe you're here and you're already a child of God. Your life is not right. Maybe you haven't been praying like you should. You've been there before? Now's the time to wake up and realize, hey, I don't need to let a moment pass without making sure that I'm praying all the time. Whatever your need may be, won't you come as we stand and as we sing? What will you